Well, 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 do I have a story for you? Do I have a story for your beautiful, sweet little ears? I broke my leg. That's right. I'll tell you all about how I broke my leg and tore my ACL ligament, all in pre-intermediate English. It's a great story. So some storytelling today. I'll tell you all about the wonderful and, of course, very humbling life lessons I've learned. And we'll practice some grammar, some third conditional sentences. For example, if I hadn't gone in for the ball, I wouldn't have broken my leg. Had I not broken my leg, I would not have made a website in my free time. This third conditional, using if, is to talk about events in the past that cannot be changed. So people use it to talk about regret. Regret. Oh, had I not married him, I'd still be happy. That's the thing. My favorite way to help you naturally pick up grammar is just to give you lots of examples of it to expose you to it. Just like, for example, my leg. My leg being exposed to my own teammate on the football pitch. My own teammate at the wrong time. That's right. The funny thing is, my leg was broken by a man on my own team. How ridiculous. Welcome back, everyone. Remember, we have worksheets and all podcasts and all worksheets are all on one place. www.simpleenglishlistening.com. Visit simpleenglishlistening.com for free online Google quizzes of reading, writing, vocabulary, grammar exercises related to the podcasts that we do. And if possible, in return for all these so many hours it takes me to create this free content for you, please, if you can, interact, subscribe, follow, review, leave a comment. You can review on Spotify, on Apple, give us out of 5 stars. And this helps the podcast grow, which gives me a sense of reward, a feeling of reward for helping everyone improve their English. On the website, you can even donate if you like. Donate, no pressure, of course. A few pennies wouldn't help me pay for the podcast hosting and the website costs. Okay, on with the story. I broke my leg. And I now have a new job. I'm designing and running the website, making a new website for a hiking and travel company here in Vietnam. And I go to Canada and San Francisco in three weeks to visit my family with a broken leg. A broken leg. So I have no idea what to do about that. I can't get my money back for the flights because I got the cheapest tickets that were like $2,000. Down the toilet, $2,000. If I do not go, or maybe I just go with my broken leg that turns red if I stand up for too long and looks like it's gonna explode. My flight is about 8 weeks from the break, 8 weeks from the injury. So maybe I'll be able to walk again, but I mean, I'm going straight to San Francisco, the city of hills and hiking and bicycling. But anyway, I have a plan. I have a really hilarious plan, actually. I'll tell you towards the end of the podcast. Okay, right. How did I break my leg? Here's the story. So I started playing football here in Hanoi in Vietnam. Football. And I was loving it. It was the perfect form of exercise because I like exercises where my mind can be kept busy, right? In football, there's strategy, there's technique that you can continuously improve at. You can watch YouTube videos of how to pass, how to shoot better. I was enjoying my new exercise passion. So I joined a team, my school team. I joined the team at my Korean school here in Vietnam. All my students are Korean. I work at a Korean school, but in Vietnam. So everyone's from South Korea. There are many Koreans here, actually. Lots of Korean businesses and industry here in Vietnam. Samsung, KG, car manufacturers like Hyundai. I am the teacher of their kids, basically. So anyway, on my Korean school team in Vietnam, there are other 30 to 50-year-old teachers. You know, some of them with grey hair, some of them with no hair, some of them with bellies, like big stomachs, some of them with glasses, some of them smoking cigarettes at half time. None of them taking the game seriously. You know, well, besides this one English guy who shouts at everyone, who's always red in the face. He's like, come on, lads, come on. You know, he takes it seriously, but he's the only one. And if you miss the shot, he's like, mate, right at the goalie. Why'd you do that? You know, but anyway, everyone else doesn't take it seriously. None of us professional athletes. We had played a few games, but this week we were up against the firefighters. Against the firefighters. People who can, you know, carry oxygen tanks, 20 kilograms of gear, up ladders. People who are trained to walk around burning buildings in the fire for hours on end, searching for survivors. People who are trained to do that. Us against them. Before I continue it, if you could smash the like button, subscribe, leave a review, blah, 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 help us grow, right? Okay, so we were playing, and it was 1-1. Somehow, 1-1. My teammate took another shot. The ball bounced off the goalie. The ball was at the edge of the box. What a great chance to make it 2-1. There were no defenders, and I was about to make it 2-1, and I pulled my leg back, about to hammer the ball into the back of the net. But my teammate had the same idea. I screamed, mine! And that's what we do in football, right? You shout for the ball, mine! And then suddenly, boom, I don't remember anything. Suddenly, I was on the floor, rolling around on the floor, holding my knee. Just like when you see football players rolling around on the floor in the World Cup. But they pretend half the time. I was not pretending, rolling around on the floor, arm over my face, in my pain. And my pain was real, but it was a strange kind of pain. Like I hit my funny bone. You know the funny bone? So it's just like a weird kind of elastic kind of feeling. It's like hitting that, but times 10. Yeah, like times 10 the intensity. What happened is that my teammate kicked my knee instead of the ball. While I was balancing on one leg, and my teammate kicked that leg. Okay? And, well, had he not kicked my leg, I wouldn't have broken it. Had I not screamed, mine, and jumped in for the shot, he wouldn't have accidentally kicked my leg. Oh, the regret. The third conditional grammar point there. Had I not screamed, mine, and jumped in for the shot, acting like I had a 16-year-old's body instead of a 37-year-old's body, I wouldn't have broken my leg. Anyways, also, guys, I'm using the past continuous verb tense so much telling this story. So also listen to the story again and notice how I'm using the past continuous tense. We use the past continuous and the past simple together to talk about actions that happen in the middle of doing a longer action. For example, my teammate kicked my knee while I was balancing on one leg. So one action happening inside the time a longer action is happening. So in the time I was balancing on one leg, my knee was kicked. This is how we use the past continuous. We'll come back to this grammar point in a future episode. So anyways, my teammate who kicked me, he's a lovely man, a super sweet elementary school teacher, a Korean guy. He looked more shocked and surprised than I was. The Vietnamese people we were playing with, they ran over and they started massaging my knee, rubbing it, pulling it, and by the looks of it, trying to do some kind of Reiki or voodoo magic to it. So my shocked, PTSD shocked Korean friend teacher who kicked my leg helped me off the pitch. I remember I couldn't put any pressure on my foot. My foot was just floppy, had no strength, zero strength, and it was dragging behind me. I could not stand on it at all. I sat down on the bench, then the adrenaline kicks in, yeah? Adrenaline injected into my veins and a sudden crazy energy. Suddenly, I thought I was okay. I thought I could walk again. Yes, I could walk again. So I thought I could jog again. So I started to lightly jog, but then suddenly my knee felt like it went to the bottom of my leg. My kneecap felt like it bounced down and up my leg, like boing, boing, my kneecap. And I fell down onto the floor again. Quickly now, it started to swell up. To swell up means that it started to get bigger and bigger, my knee, like a balloon. Soon, it looked like an elephant's knee. I went upstairs, hobbling on one leg. I went upstairs to my office, using the elevator, of course, and I got ice from the freezer. Now it was getting big. But I had a meeting about this podcast with some company in Mexico on Skype. So I did the meeting for 20 minutes. We laughed about my leg. I thought it can't be that bad. I've never broken a bone before. Well, before that day. After the meeting, I noticed I could hardly move my leg. I could barely move it. Now I went downstairs to get dinner, which is served at our school. I had dinner and I was hobbling. Hobbling means like dragging one leg. Hobbling is like verb, like walking like a zombie, yeah? Hobbling like a zombie, dragging a leg. I got to my bike, to my scooter, to drive home. And at this point, my leg was completely stiff. Stiff, adjective. I could not move it at all. It was completely stiff. and I could not even put my leg onto the bottom part of my scooter. So I just hung my leg off the side of my scooter. I rode to the nearest hospital and drove my bike to the front. But the man shouted at me to park my bike across the road. So I was like, oh. So I parked my bike across the road in the parking. And then I had to hop on one leg. To hop means to jump on one leg. I had to hop across the road in Vietnam, busy road. There was a huge bus coming and I was hopping on one leg across the road, bikes everywhere, to get to the front door of the hospital. And finally, the same man who shouted at me to park my bike across, he runs outside with a wheelchair. I get in the wheelchair. This hospital is a private hospital. And the problem in Vietnam is that many private hospitals will tell you you need everything. X-rays, CT scans, MRI scans, surgery, even if it's swollen. Swollen means when it's very big and full of water and blood. So my knee was swollen, very much so. Normally, you should not do surgery when something is too swollen because it can get infected. But at this Vietnamese private hospital, did they give a damn? Because I had money, and that's what they wanted. So maybe they don't care if my leg gets infected. Also, you can't do an MRI scan if it's too swollen. But they tried to make me do one anyways. I refused after doing research online, after talking to some friends. They said, sir, you need surgery ASAP because you have a grade 3 ACL ligament tear. This is the kind of injury that ends footballers' careers. They told me I must have surgery tomorrow, they said. I replied, okay. Give me the X-ray result now. I think I'll go somewhere else now and get a second opinion. In Vietnam, the best doctors work at the big, famous government hospitals. At these places, you can become, you know, like a legendary doctor, and patients will pay you lots if you fix them. And they're known for giving more honest advice because they don't need your money and they won't make money from X-rays and CT scans. So the second opinion at the government hospital was an old guy with gray hair with red eyes. And he looked like he had seen this a million times before. And it's good to have an older doctor. If you have a doctor, yeah, for something important, make sure there's a few gray hairs on their head. The classic saying, young doctors fill graveyards. Anyway, at the government hospital, the older doctor said I only had a grade 1 ACL tear and that I don't need surgery. Surprise, surprise. And also that my leg was broken. They didn't highlight that at the previous place. The previous hospital seemed to downplay the fact that my tibia bone was broken at the top. So yay! 8 weeks before I have to fly to the USA and Canada. That's right, in 8 weeks I have to fly. 3 weeks from this recording. Well, I'll tell you about my plan for this trip to at the end of the podcast. So they put me in a plaster cast. My whole leg, a plaster cast. Well, sorry, I say cast. I'm from the south of England. Cast. A plaster cast. God, what's wrong with my accent? I've been living abroad. A plaster cast is a big white hard cast they put on your leg, so you cannot move it or bend it. This is another word from the worksheet. Go on www.simpleenglishlistening.com and do the worksheet to learn these vocabulary words. So before they put me in the plaster cast, they had to drain the swelling because my leg was very, very, very big. And so much blood came out. Actually, I couldn't look, but my girlfriend just looked at me and she was just like, there's so much blood. There's so much blood is coming out. And I was like, okay, stop. You know, no need to tell me. Tell me later, at least. Anyway, so this government hospital is like a factory of fixing people. It's the main place people come in the north of Vietnam for serious things, for bike crashes, for big accidents. It has the most trusted surgeons and doctors for these big, important surgeries. I saw someone who looked like their genitals, like their dick and balls, was just like, oh, like a maybe gone. Mate, honestly, like it's just a big bloody bandage there and like watery blood coming out in I can't go into too much detail. I saw someone with half of their head caved in, so their skull had like cracked, I guess, and their head was like significantly pressed in. Looked like they had half a head, but they were alive. But they not in good condition. Their wife was like feeding them. I saw someone, I think, with a bit of their brain maybe coming out. It was like a big bandage like coming outwards on the side of their head. And they had like a kind of scar, kind of like Frankenstein kind of scar, like on their forehead. It was an intense place because in Vietnam, there's lots of accidents, right? Accidents on the road. Really intense. This is a Viet Duc hospital for those from Hanoi who are listening. Maybe you know. It would be a very difficult place to work, to see that suffering every day. So my hat's off, my deep respect for the people who work there, busy every day with these kinds of patients. I think you have to have a certain kind of personality to work at these places. I think I would be too sensitive. I'm sure many people are, right? My aunt is a nurse at these kinds of places. Yeah, I mean, I think it affected her permanently. I had to do an x-ray there at a later day, and it took 3 hours. 3 hours of waiting in a super busy corridor with no seats. Anyways, so they gave me 2 crutches. Crutches are the 2 metal things that help you walk. Yeah, when you've hurt your legs. You know, when someone's got a plaster cast, they've got 2 big metal instruments in the metal things on the sides that they use to help them walk, crutches. And there I was, the all new me, transformed. Optimus Prime would be proud. I'd stand next to Bumblebee, the new Transformer, half man, half metal machine, a big white plaster cast on my leg. 2 shiny new crutches to help me walk. And at first, they were so difficult. But you do quickly adjust to them. You quickly get used to these crutches. Now I can go forwards on the crutches. I can go backwards on them. But I can do a few dance moves, but I can't quite do parkour or do tricks on them. But some people can. I've seen it online. A man who does parkour on crutches. Amazing. At the beginning, I could not get down the 2 flights of stairs at my apartment. I was running short of water. I had no food. I was trapped upstairs. I couldn't work. I couldn't go to school. And my girlfriend lives a 2-hour flight away in Ho Chi Minh City, and I'm in Hanoi, stuck at the top of my stairs. But luckily, she flew up by surprise. She flew up from where she lives in Ho Chi Minh City, 2 hours flight, and she helped me for the first 2 weeks, something I deeply appreciate. Made those 2 weeks much easier. The next thing, from recovering from a broken bone, the next thing is the physiotherapy means the exercises that you do to strengthen the muscles in that leg so you can make a full recovery. After 6 weeks in a cast, your leg looks... My leg started to look like an old man's leg. It was skinny, like a stick. Yeah, it was like a stick leg, and much skinnier than my other leg. And the top, the muscle, my thigh muscle, it just turned into like kind of a fatty kind of tissue. I didn't get much advice. I didn't get any advice for physiotherapy. Because at the Vietnamese government hospital, it's so busy that it's like a factory. Yeah? Next, next, next. When I saw the doctor, there were four other people in the room with me. He saw my leg. Next, looks at the next person's wrist. Blah, 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 blah. Next, looks at the next person's knee. Blah, blah, blah. Zero advice about physiotherapy. So this was something I had to learn about alone. Online, I joined a community on Facebook with other sufferers of my kind of leg break. The leg break is a tibial plateau break, which is basically you have two big bones in your leg, yes? Put simply, your thigh bone, the top one, and your calf bone, which goes from your knee to your foot. It's the top of the calf bone that was cracked. So I found a Facebook group of other sufferers of this specific kind of leg break, and I fully suggest it. Yeah, there's a great support network on Facebook for things like this. If you're suffering something alone, know that with the internet, and especially, of course, if you can speak English, because 55% of all of the internet is in English. There are communities out there for every kind of problem, and you are never alone. I found lots of advice there on YouTube videos of patients, as well as doctors and physiotherapists sharing their best exercises to do. The purpose of physiotherapy is to strengthen the leg, to strengthen it, to make it stronger, so it is ready to walk again with your other leg without getting hurt once again. So you strengthen the hurt leg. Luckily, by fortune, by the grace of the Lord, or whatever powers that be, my dear friend from Canada put me in touch with her relative, who is a knee specialist in Boston, in the USA. A well-educated city, right? You have Harvard and MIT there. Anyway, so he also gave me lots of advice, and he helped me through the recovery anytime I had a question. So now I'm doing the exercises that he suggested that I got from the internet. And from last week, I'm back at work. I had to stop working for about 4 weeks, but now I'm back. I'm just sat in the corner of one class. They put me in like a Tristan's class. I have a microphone because I can't stand up, right, to deal with the kids. And I have a little bell, ding, 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 to make the students shut the hell up when they need to. And I have a wheelchair. So now I'm the demon in the wheelchair going around my school, All that's missing is red eyes and white hair in my wheelchair for the perfect look. Well, my hair's turning grey, but not white quite yet. When it is white, I'll give you an episode about that. Okay, so the lessons learned. What did I learn in this experience? I have a whole new respect for people who have to live with one leg or one arm. That's for sure. It's so hard to adjust at first. The first 2 weeks with my crutches was so difficult that honestly, I nearly cried. I nearly cried once on the second day because I just couldn't do anything. Couldn't shower, couldn't go to the toilet without taking off all of my clothes. But you do get used to this new lifestyle. But of course, life is never the same. And I was thinking, you know, it's a mental game. I was thinking, what if I never recover? What if I can never play football again? Or I can never do this again, never do that again? I mean, there are so many things you can do in life that, you know, there's always opportunities. New doors are opening every time others are closing. I mean, it's a small break. So to be honest, like, I will get better. I mean, statistically, I should be completely all right again. And of course, thank the universe, thank God, whatever it is you believe, I'm so lucky that I will recover again. What about those young boys from, you know, Ukraine and Russia, who just have their legs blown off forever, or no legs? I mean, with everything, it can be worse, of course, right? It's a humbling experience. And actually, I would say it's an important experience. It's an important experience to really get hurt at some point and recover, of course. Well, they say, right? There's the classic idiom, not really an idiom, the classic saying, whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger in the end. I'm sure many of you have experienced that in your lives. Next, I have a new job. I'm making a website for a hiking and travel company. My first ever try at making a website. Yeah, for an e-commerce website. So that's exciting because maybe this is my new career direction. So I did have plans of doing 2 podcasts per month. Remember 2 months ago I said, everyone, there'll be 2 podcasts a month. But that's on hold. You must remember this is a passion project of mine. It's like a hobby, right? And it's a rewarding one. I'm receiving quite a lot of comments and fan mail and people saying to me how much this podcast has helped them learn English. It's really inspiring to receive these kinds of messages. But anyway, my point is, it will still be one podcast per month and one worksheet a month, okay, on the website. So that's the plan for, I don't know how long for, but yeah, on the first day of every month, you'll get both of those things. And remember, the worksheet's got reading, writing, vocabulary, and grammar practice, okay? That is linked to the podcast topic. So the crazy thing is that I'm going to San Francisco, yeah? And Canada in 3 weeks with a broken leg. What? I was planning to see the great, big, majestic redwood trees. Some of the biggest trees in the world. The Golden Gate Bridge. What am I going to do with a broken leg? These are really expensive flights from Hanoi. It's not often I'm able to see my family in Montreal and Toronto on the other side of the world, because obviously it's too pricey and the time difference messes you up. It's exactly 12 hours in the past. So it's the worst time difference that exists, basically. It takes me like 2 weeks to adjust both ways. Anyway, I can't get the money back for my flights because I got the cheapest flights. Typical of me. So, will I go with two crutches and a broken leg? Maybe they'll give me an upgrade. An upgrade to business class. Don't mind if I do. Or I'll postpone it to fly a bit later. But that costs $810 American to postpone the flight to a later date. So, I don't know. What do I do? And then, I had an idea. I had an amazing idea. America is the land of the free, but also of the very, very, very big, gigantic people. Some people there slightly smaller than a house. Right? That's the truth, unfortunately. So I rented a mobility scooter for my time in San Francisco. A mobility scooter, which is a small scooter for a disabled person. And you don't need a license because it counts as a pedestrian. I rang them first and I asked, yeah, I got the idea because I watched a show and one of the characters, his whole family is on these mobility scooters, like American family. It's like a thing over there. So I rang them and I asked, can the mobility scooter go across the Golden Gate Bridge to the Redwood Trees and back to Pacific Heights, which will be my neighborhood? Can it do this trip? And they were like, yeah, if it's fully charged, you know, you can do it. So there we go. I'll try and take some pictures and show them on one of the social media platforms. Third conditional. Had I not broken my leg, I would not be able to enjoy the mobility scooter. So there we go. If anyone out there lives in San Francisco, I'll be there from the 7th of July to the 12th of July. And I know many listeners are actually American, people who live in America learning English. Feel free to get in contact and we can have a coffee, see something. Might be fun. Still, when I stand up, the foot on my injured leg turns red. Turns red because of all the blood going down into it. Oh, imagine flying with that. What happens if my foot just explodes on the airplane? Or opens, oh, like a sausage being barbecued? We'll soon see, eh? Anyways, lots of love, guys. As always, this has been a real pleasure. See you next time. I'll let you know how my traveling goes in the episode after the next one. The next episode is already recorded. It's an interview with a dear friend of mine here in Hanoi. He is like an explorer and he goes to small villages and ethnic communities in Vietnam and learns about their culture and all of this. And he's very much into ancient mysteries and UFOs and these kinds of things. So I'll chat a bit about that, which is something that excites me. There's a small chance I won't be able to do an episode next month if I don't have time, because I'm leaving my microphone and all of my stuff here in Vietnam. I'm not going to take it with me to San Francisco. So yeah, so forgive me if I'm unable to do an episode on the 1st of August. See you guys. Take care and have an amazing month full of joy and blessings. And I hope you all make the most of it.